done and dusted with the Union Budget of 2020. So in case you missed out on what was the longest budget in the history of budget speeches ever, let me walk you through some of the seminal points of that document and those announcements. The big takeaway for me, frankly, is that there is no big takeaway. I know expectations should be watered down from the budget, but given the situation as it stands, both in terms of growth and unemployment, I think there was a lot riding on the finance minister today and what she might have laid out, at least in terms of an intent roadmap. I would be interested as well to see what global market watchers will make of this and what their takeaway will be for India going into 2020. But the big points. The first one is that there is predictably fiscal slippage. So for the current year, it's been set at 3.8% versus 3.3%. For the next year, it's been set at 3.5%. That is likely to be skipped or tripped on as well. I think a lot of economists were working with a 4% band, something as wide as that. So there is going to be some strife on the fiscal deficit side for this country and for the government this time round. Expenditure, interestingly, has been tweaked a little bit. There haven't been any big clampdowns, but things like the PM Kisan scheme, etc., didn't have the kind of outgo that was expected. And I think over there, there's been a little bit of relief for the government on its expenditure side. What was interesting was an extremely ambitious divestment target. This is ironic because in the year gone by, the government has actually earned only a fraction of what it set out. So with a target of 1 lakh crores, the government ended up earning only about 8,000 crores through divestment. And for the coming year, the divestment target has been set at an extremely ambitious 2 lakh crores. This will be raised from two prime parties. IDBI Bank will go public. The government will be selling its remainder 40% plus stake. And LIC, surprise, surprise, will also be hitting the stock market. There are some question marks on this. IDBI Bank is currently ridden with bad debts. So it will be a question mark in terms of what kind of interest and appetite they see and what price this deal finally gets at. Again, for LIC, it seems like if last year was RBI's turn, this time it's LIC's. So LIC, it seems, will now privatize itself and be raising some money, hopefully, for the government, because that's a big target to fill at 2 lakh crores. There are going to be some higher non-tax revenues. I think that line item is probably leaning heavily on the telecom companies because the number has been bumped up significantly for the year ahead. So let's wait and watch on what's expected from the telecom companies and what they can deliver in terms of outgo to the government. The other grey area is the growth target. 6% is what has been set out, roughly inflation adjusted as the growth target. Given where we're standing at right now, the economic survey was also a 6 and 6.5% range, which seemed difficult to reach. And 6% as well at this point is a bit of an up in the air situation. So I think on the growth as well, there will be some, you know, some surmise about how exactly this is going to be achieved. Let's move to what this means for you and I, or what kind of big takeaways there are for the individual citizen from the union budget. There was an entirely new category of personal income tax slabs that was announced. So there's now two regimes, the older pre-existing regime and a new one, which has both more slabs and reduced rates as well, particularly for the line that goes below 15 lakh in terms of an income. 5 lakh, of course, is not taxed, but from 5 lakh to 15 lakh, there are now reduced rates. It comes at a cost. There will be no exemptions provided in this new regime. So I think this is now going to become quite a complicated affair of working along with your chartered accountants and your tax consultants to figure out whether or not you should stick with the previous regime, and you have that choice, or going into the new regime and actually choosing this set without any exemptions. Remember things like the exemptions you get on housing or on insurance or on transport, all set to go. The opinion is divided on this one. Some tax officials feel that perhaps for the below 15 lakh category, there is some relief to be found in the new scheme, albeit quite minimal in terms of the tax saving. Whereas others feel that if you have tax outgoes or cost outgoes like school fees, etc., this doesn't make too much sense. So, you know, has this been very friendly towards the personal, the personal income tax level? I think that one will take a few days to figure out. There is also the possibility idea of some items becoming more expensive for consumers. Customs duties have been hiked on things like furniture and footwear. Customs duties have been hiked on auto and auto parts. Excise duties have been hiked for cigarettes and tobacco. And I think, and for telecom, as for mobile phones as well, customs duty, some parts of them have been hiked. So I think that could translate into incrementally higher prices for consumers on some of those categories. Disappointing that I didn't hear enough about employment. There was neither any talk about even affirming the fact that there is an employment crisis at hand, a 45-year high, especially for the urban and rural youth. No comment on that, neither on any specific schemes. In fact, there wasn't even a greater spend put towards the pre-existing and larger scheme right now, which is MG Narega. So spend on MG Narega has actually been allocated at 61,500 crores, which is way lower than what the government ended up spending in the previous year, which is over 70,000 crores. I'm not sure if the government is underestimating what they are looking to spend on MG Narega, or they just expect it to peter down. Anyhow, it was disappointing that there wasn't enough even addressed on the unemployment situation. The big disappointment was for the stock market. In recent history, I don't remember the market closing down a whopping 1,000 points. That's 2.5% down for the Sensex. They pushed for trading on Saturday. They got it. I guess they were expecting some big headline item. They didn't get that. And they didn't get much by way of tax relief either. There was no word on LTCG, so long-term capital gains tax stays. There was no word on STT, so that one stays as well. And now there is a dividend distribution tax, which the recipient must pay. So while the onus has been removed from the company, it still looks like it's becoming more and more irksome or less fruitful to be investing in the stock market, because the onus of tax pay or tax outgo is constantly getting piled onto the individual investor. There were a few positives, so let me end with that. It was heartening to see that the deposit insurance hike has been moved to 5 lakh versus 1 lakh. I think this is coming off from the PMC Bank episode. 1 lakh was way too low. It's the first time it's been moved in 27 years. It could have been more, but at least this is a start. So 5 lakh is what it stands at right now. Personal income tax, like I said, I think will be a bit of a personal discovery for you. So depending on what your spends are, depending on what your household setup is, it could work in your favor or against to switch into the new regime. And of course, the other interesting one was the climate change spend, which was hiked significantly in this budget to 4,400 crores. I think it's not clear yet whether it covers issues like air pollution, but at least it is a start in that direction and actually addressing something that is becoming a problem, not just nationally, but globally. What happens from Monday? I think we get on with the business of getting on. The budget has become a bit of a standard document. It was uninspiring, to put it mildly. And I think now the bigger question remains on what the government intends to do as it steps into 2020 and actually begins to address some of the core problems like unemployment and growth.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.